Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos. In this video, I'm going to solve exercise 2.17 of the textbook, first course in probability. So in this poem, we place 8 rooks at random on the chessboard, and the goal is to find the probability that none of them can capture another one. So the only thing you need to know about chess to solve the poem is the fact that one, a chessboard is an 8x8 grid, so that has 64 squares, and also the fact that rooks can only move horizontally or vertically any number of squares. So the problem is mathematically equivalent to the following. If we place 8 rooks on an 8x8 grid, what is the probability that no two of them are on the same horizontal or vertical line? That's exactly what we want to do. Now, you see that because we obviously assume that all the possible outcomes are equally likely, we are in the context of symmetric probability space. The goal is going to be to, in order to find the probability, the goal is going to be to find the total number of outcomes such that all the rooks are on different lines, horizontally or vertically, divided by the total number of possible outcomes. But you see that at this step, we are already facing one problem, which is, well, what is the total number of possible ways we can place those rooks if we assume that the rooks are identical, or if we assume that the rooks are not identical, things are going to change. Indeed, if all the rooks are identical and you exchange two of them, you don't change anything. But if the rooks are all distinguishable, let's say 8 different colors, then in this case, exchanging two of them is going to create a new configuration on the chessboard. So it seems that already the size of the sample space is going to depend on whether we assume that the rooks are distinguishable or not, and the problem doesn't precise this aspect. But it turns out that obviously that you assume that they are distinguishable or not should not change the probability we are looking at. So in fact, assuming that the rooks are distinguishable or not is going to change the counting aspect of the solution, but eventually we are going to end up with the same answer looking at the probability. So in this problem, in this video, I'm going to solve the problem using those two different strategies. First, we are going to do it assuming that the rooks are distinguishable, and then assuming that they are not. So first, let's assume that the rooks are distinguishable. So in this case, let's try to understand the cardinal of omega. So for that, I'm going to draw the chessboard first so that we understand what's going on. Okay, so now to compute the size of the sample space, assuming that, again, the rooks are distinguishable, we are going to do the following. So cardinal of omega now is going to be equal to, well, you have clearly for the first rook, let's say a black one, you are going to have 64 possibilities because there are 64 squares. So you start with a 64. And so assuming that you place the rook here, then for the second one, let's say a white rook, you are going to have 64 minus 1 possibilities, that's 63. Okay, so times 63. And then 62 for the next one, and so on. And eventually, you go up to 64 minus 8 plus 1, so that's 57. That's the number of possibilities you have, the number of squares remaining to place the last rook, number 8. And you see that this number can be written also in this form, that's 64 factorial divided by 56 factorial, that corresponds to a number of arrangements without repetition. So arrangement means that the order is important, and here the reason why the order is important is because the rooks are distinguishable. So if you put black one here, white one here, or first the red one here and the black one here, that's not going to be the same. So the order is important. And without repetition, because you cannot put two rooks on the same square. That's where this arrangement with repetition comes from. Without repetition comes from. So that's going to be the size of our sample space. So now what we want to understand is the event A that no two rooks on same line. That's our event of interest. And the total number of outcomes in this event in the context where the rooks are distinguishable is going to be the following. So to count this, the cardinal of A, so number of outcomes in this event. Now I'm going to use the picture also. And so you see that for the, so now again, you have your eight different rooks. You are going to take the first, put the first one somewhere on the chessboard. There is no restriction for the first one. Let's put it here, for instance. So you have 64 possibilities to place the very first rook. And then you need to multiply by the number of ways you can position the second rook somewhere. So here, because we don't want any two on the same line, either vertically or horizontally, that means that those two lines here are forbidden now. We cannot use them anymore. Okay. And so now we have to choose for the second rook one of those remaining squares. And you see that after removing those two red lines, if you put together the four pieces here together, you are going to end up with a 7x7 grid instead of an 8x8 grid. That has exactly 7 squared equals 49 squares. And so the number of possibilities for the second rook is going to be 49. So let's say you put it here. And then you keep going. You can, of course, after this step two, those ones are not allowed anymore. You cannot put the third, the other rooks on this column or on this row here. And so following the same reasoning, again, you are going to end up with putting the pieces together after removing the red region with a 6x6 grid, so that has 36 possible squares. So then you have 36 and so on. And you look at the product of all the squares, and if you repeat that exactly 8 times, eventually for the last rook, you are going to have only one possibility. So you have a product like that, that goes down from 64 to 1. That's exactly the product of all the squares, of all the perfect squares, from 1 to 64. Then you can rewrite this in this form, so that's 8 squared times 7 squared times 6 squared, and so on, up to 1 squared. Without the square, you get 1 times 2 times 3 up to 8, that's exactly 8 factorial. And so eventually you conclude that the total number of outcomes here is equal to 8 factorial square. So from that, you can deduce the probability of A. The probability of A is going to be exactly this 8 factorial square divided by that number. And so I can write that here. So eventually you get that the probability of A is going to be equal to 8 factorial square times 1 over this. So that's going to be a 56 factorial divided by 64 factorial. Now, if you use a calculator to compute this quantity, you would find the number that you see right now at the bottom of your screen. That's obviously a very small probability. So now let's move on to the case where number two, the rooks are assumed to be identical. So that's The second case, let's assume that the rooks are identical. Then we still have the same event A, okay? That no two of the rooks can be on the same line horizontally or vertically. But now we are going to obviously change the size of the sample space. So this cardinal here is not correct anymore. And so instead, we are going to have that the cardinal of omega. Now, because the rooks are assumed to be identical, that means that the number of ways you can place those 8 rooks on the grid here is exactly going to be the total number of possible choices of 8 positions out of those 64 squares. So, in the previous question, we proceed sequentially to put the rooks, because of course if you put the black one first here and then the red one, or you put the red one here and the black one here, you change something. But here, because the order in which you put the rooks does not really matter because they are all identical, instead of counting things sequentially by pulling the rooks one by one, what you can just do is just say, let's just choose 8 squares from the set of 64 squares. So that means that now the new size for your sample space in the case of identical rooks is going to be 64 choose 8. Okay? Now, again, we want to compute the cardinal of A, but in this new context of identical rooks, okay? And so for that, I'm going to draw a new chessboard here. Okay, so, and now, the goal to compute the cardinal of A is going to be to compute the total number of ways you can choose simultaneously 8 squares from this grid of 8x8 square in such a way that no two of them are on the same horizontal or vertical line. So, so for that, the trick to do this counting is to see that because you cannot have two on the same line, that means that on each of the 8 columns, you can have at most one, okay? At most one rook. But because there are 8 total, that means that you need to have at least one per column. And so that means that you need to have exactly one rook on each column, and also exactly one on each row. That's the trick we are going to use to count the number of outcomes in omega. Okay? So in the event S, right? So again, in how many ways we can choose 8 of those squares in such a way that there is exactly one square on each column. Okay? So the way we proceed is just, well, we are going to again now look at the columns one by one, so sequentially, even if the goal is to compute probability that, I mean, the number of ways you can choose simultaneously x squared, but 8 squared, but not on the same line. So for the first column, well, you would have 8 possible positions for your group, let's say, so an 8 here, but then you see that, as before, there are, like, this row becomes forbidden now for the second rook, okay? So you have only, for the second one, only 7 possibilities here. So let's put it here, for instance. And then, so that's 7 possibilities. Then you cannot place the third one on any of those two rows, and then that gives you 6 possibilities for the third one. Let's put it here, for instance, 6, and you keep going. Then you have a 5, 4, 3, 2, and 1. So eventually that tells you that the number of ways you can choose 8 squares from this 8x8 grid in such a way that no two of them are on the same horizontal or vertical line is going to be equal to the product of those numbers, That's exactly 8 factorial. Okay? So now we have this new size, I mean this new number of outcomes for the sample space, and this new number of outcomes for, like, in the event A. I'm going to rewrite it here. So we have cardinal of A equals 8 factorial. Now from that we can deduce our probability. So now the probability of A, like here, but in the case where rooks are identical, is going to be equal again to the fraction 8 factorial divided by 64, choose 8 factorial, so 8 factorial divided by 64, choose 8, 8 factorial divided by 54, 64, choose 8. Now, you see that the 64 choose 8 is a 64 factorial divided by 8 factorial times 64 minus 8, it's 56 factorial. And so, eventually, you end up with 8 factorial divided by 64 factorial here. But then you still have, in the denominator, here you have an 8 factorial times 56 factorial that goes back here. So the 8 factorial times this one gives you an 8 factorial square, and you still need to multiply by 56 factorial. So conclusion, you see that if we assume that the rooks are identical now, we change the size, the number of outcomes in A, but also the number of outcomes in omega. Eventually, we get this number. After simplification or expansion of this expression, we get this. That's exactly what we found before. So that means that it doesn't matter whether you assume that the rooks are identical or distinguishable. You are not going to affect the probability of A. That's what we were expecting. That means that the prime is well posed and so on. And in fact, what's going on here is that assuming that the rooks are identical, you are going to reduce the size of your sample space, but by a factor equal to, in fact, 8 factorial, but you are also going to reduce the number of outcomes in A by the same factor, 8 factorial, such that eventually, you, looking at the fraction, you end up with the same numbers, and those two probabilities are indeed identical.